the ring, to the backstage, and everything beyond, you're about to get some real heat from Houston.
Tell me he didn't just say that.
This is Heated Conversations with Hall of Famer Booker T on Sports Radio 610.
Can you dig it, sucker?
Yeah. Let me turn that up. Yeah. Yeah. Yeah, there it is right there. Hey, guys, welcome to another edition of Heated Conversations right here on Sports Radio 610. I'm your man, the five-time champ, Booker T. Always doing it like it's supposed to be done. Got my man, Brad Gilmore, right next to me, as always. What's going on, Bradley?
Hey, what's going on, Booker? You know what would make this intro music even better?
What's that?
If Enzo Amore was rapping on
man,
it.
Man, I'm going to tell you, man, Enzo Amore, man, stuff is hot. You know, it's real hot. You know, we ain't going to do that.
You know what the old school term was? You know, hotter than Georgia asphalt.
You know
right?
what I mean? Hotter than a Mexican plate lunch.
That's another good one. I like that.
That's what I like.
How's right it there. Going, Book?
Man, it's good, man. It's real good. Eddie Ed, what's up, dog?
Hey, what's going on, man? How you feeling?
Man, I'm feeling real good, man. I'm feeling real good today.
Hey, first, real quick, I want to thank you for the Monday Night Raw tickets you gave me a couple weeks ago.
Oh, man, I forgot all about that. Man. How was the show?
The show was awesome, man. That was my first show ever.
Yeah, good time. How was the tickets?
The tickets was good. The seats was amazing, man. Yeah, I was right there.
I told my boy, Rubenstein, you know, that's what I call Ed Rubenstein. Hey, man, hook my boy up. Hook him up with some good seats. Make sure you got front row. I don't know if they were front row.
it was close enough.
Man, that's what we do, man. Anytime you want to go check out some WWE action, I'm right here. If you want to check out some wrestling right here in the city of the H, man, in Houston, Reality of Wrestling, always doing our thing. Right now, we're on the road to Summer Champions. Got on the line, the road to Summer of Champions, guys. It's going to be going down July 14th at World Gym Arena. And I'm going to tell you, man, that's going to be good. It's going to be on. I can't wait to the matches. I can't wait to see the main event. I can't wait to see the confrontation between Gino and Rex Andrews. That right there. I'm looking forward to, what surprises we're going to have as far as Summer of Champions go. We already made one announcement. Juventud Guerrera going to be taking on Chavo Guerrero Jr. In the main event, special attraction match, guys. You don't want to miss out on that. That's going to be going down. That's actually Summer Champions in August. That's special attraction match. But I tell you, July 14th, we got some big matches going down. You don't want to miss out.
Yeah, the fifth match in the best of five series between the Mysterious Q and Aiden Christiano will be decided July the 14th. You will see who will be the Texas champion going into Summer of Champions 5. So that's going to be really awesome to see. And there's always great action. And if you were at the last show, I know y'all going to want to come and check out to see what the aftermath of that main event was.
You know what? We don't want to leak that.
Right? I'm not going to leak it. I'm just saying, if you were there, you know that you got to come out and see what the aftermath is.
I tell you what. If you were there, you know you want to get back for the next show because it was not a seat left in the house. It was standing room only. And I appreciate all the fans for coming out and repping Reality of Wrestling. Hey, you know what? If you guys want to come check out some Reality of Wrestling, the phone line's open.
Phone line's open. We're going to give away some tickets. You just call us right now, 713-572-4610. That's 713-572-4610. 4610, just call in, you get some tickets.
Yeah, if you a first-timer, want to see exactly what Reality of Wrestling is all about. Right now, the independent wrestling world is totally on fire. We talk about the All-In event.
Yeah.
Produced by Cody Rhodes, the Young Bucks. And, a couple of other guys. And I got to give these guys big, big props for doing something like that and letting the world see, hey, man, the independent wrestling world is totally alive. And Reality Wrestling, we're not even independent, man. We something. We are, we ride in our own lane, I think.
Yeah, we're a TV company. Yeah,
we produce.
We produce.
As well as we produce. Hey, we had actually one of my guys.
Yeah, Max Castellanos. Max Castellanos, who's been at Reality Wrestling the last couple months, who's somebody who I know you and I have talked about him off air and at the shows. Kevin Bernhardt, the director of Reality Wrestling, we talked about him. I'm like, man, I really like this guy.
You know,
Well, he made his appearance. He made an appearance at NXT.
I think this kid started down there with Rudy Boy Gonzalez down in San Antonio. Got to give Rudy Boy props as well, if I'm correct.
He's from San Antonio. I know that.
For putting this guy on and, you know, leading him in the right direction. Rudy Boy actually is the guy that took over Shawn Michaels Wrestling School up there in San Antonio. So I tell you, man, this kid came down. He showed me something. We put him on Reality of Wrestling. I said, hey, man, let's work with this guy. I mean, he's got a good look. He got that Al Perez, you know, look. You know what I mean? He got that, you know, good looking, you know, handsome, you know, rugged, you know, and then the kid can go at the same time. So
yeah.
I gave him the thumbs up. And then for him to get a shot at NXT, big ups to him, man. Big ups, Castellanos. Big ups.
I like him. You know, and he's a guy who just showed up, I remember, at the last show, and he was like, hey, you got anything for me? And we made something for him because
he was old school. He was a throwback. He had his boots in the car.
He was ready.
He said, whatever you guys need, can I do anything?
Is there anything you need me to do?
And that's what's really, really cool about Reality Wrestling as of late, because we've been getting so many guys, so much young talent from around the country showing up, wanting to be a part of Reality of Wrestling and making their way to be a part of a television show, to be able to get their faces out there on screen. I always say television is worth its weight in gold. If somebody see you, I mean, you could be a singer. Yeah, I mean, you could be a juggler. I don't care what it is. If you're good at it, you know, somebody might want to pay you money to do that. So I stress to you young guys out there and you young girls and young ladies, go out there and find what you do and enhance it. Make it the best you possibly can. And you would never have to work a day in your life. Trust me, I know.
You know, you're right, though. I mean, I think work ethic has a lot to do with it and taking advantage of an opportunity like being on television, like being on the radio, being on the air. You know, you just take advantage of it, and you make it happen, Book. You make it happen.
No, you make it happen. And the ladies at Reality of Wrestling,
yeah,
they have been taking off and doing an awesome job. This Jordan Grace, you know, I tell you, she's been—
Thick Mama Pump.
Thick Mama Pump. I'm going to tell you guys, if you have not seen Jordan Grace, Thick Mama Pump. You want to check it out. Go to YouTube. Pull her up. She's got some views, man. She's got a whole lot of views. And as well as the champion at Reality Wrestling, Hai Young, we must give her big, big props because she have been showing up each and every month doing such an awesome job. She had a match last month, and she showed me how advanced she have become in such a short amount of time. Over these last 12 months, I remember when we kicked her out of the gym.
I was going to bring that up.
I remember when we kicked her out of the gym, and I think she came and she told me she just, I just wanted to have some fun. And we told her, look, it ain't fun all the time. You know, hit the bricks, you know, bounce. And she bounced it up. And I don't know what it was. It's like a light bulb went off or something, because now Hai Young, you haven't seen Hai Young, guys, from Reality Wrestling. She is the Reality Wrestling Diamond Champion. A light bulb went off, and she totally flipped the script. I mean, she became total ring general inside the square circle. And I see her making big moves, money moves, here pretty soon.
Shout out to Cardi B. She's making money moves, Book. I like how you snuck that in there.
Hey,
you
man.
Worked it in there.
I wrote that down early.
You said money moves. Yeah, he underlined it a couple times.
Hey, man, did you hear Charlotte Flair had surgery?
She did?
Yeah. Yeah,
I didn't hear about it.
I'm not sure exactly what it was, but she's going to be out for a while. That right there, man, setbacks. You know, you don't want to have setbacks. You know,
time off, right?
Time off is one's worst enemy. You know, I think, you know, later on in the show, we're going to tap on, you know, the career of Big Cass. You was talking about Enzo Amore. We're going to talk about Big Cass later on. But talking about new things, guys, something that you, the people, you know, because with Booker T, guys, it's all about the people. and bringing it to you. Seriously. So you remember back in Hollywood?
Yeah, I know Hollywood.
Yeah, you know down there, you know, Sunset.
Yeah,
you know,
yeah.
L.A. California.
You know, we're all off on that one. Yeah.
You remember the live, you know, album we did?
Oh yeah, from Lucky Strike
Talk
Live.
Talk to him about
down there
that,
in Hollywood.
You remember? Yeah, I mean, we got something coming for the people.
We do, and I think this is a good time to announce it.
Why not?
On June the 29th.
Wait a minute, this is an exclusive. Breaking news, heated conversation.
So on 20, thank you for that, by the way, that lead in. On June the 29th, which is next Friday, we are going to release that body of work for you at home, the uncut, the full version. You heard a version on the air, of course, but this is the full version of the show, near 2 hours.
It's like the Richard Pryor drop, you know, where you hear, you know, some of it, you know, and then you hear the raw footage.
Yes.
It's going to get raw, man.
It's going to get raw.
You know, and the thing is, I didn't hold nothing back, man. I was throwing punches. I'm talking about left, right hooks, uppercuts. I'm talking about
a couple haymakers in there.
Mean, stiff jab. I'm talking about like Larry Holmes jab. You understand what I'm saying? So I'm telling you guys, you got to check it out. It's going to be coming out next Friday. You can pre-order now.
Yeah, pre-order iTunes, Amazon, Spotify, Tidal, a whole nine yards. You're going to hear guys like RVD, your old tag team partner.
Yeah, man, RVD, man, with some of the stories, man. I want to kill this guy sometime, man. The guy, he would be so high, you know what I mean? He would be out of his mind riding down the high. I'm like,
high on life.
You know, in California, it's legal. Yeah. You know what I mean? And I visited this guy, and I'm like, Rob, calm down. And so the stories I'm going to tell you about Rob Van Dam, guys, it's going to blow your mind.
And Rob's going to be there to react to him. You know, obviously Queen Charmel was there. Corey Graves, your rival, your arch nemesis, Corey Graves, was on stage with us.
Corey Graves, man, you know, and the thing is, I gave this boy a pass, man. I gave him a pass. You know what I mean? I brought him on my show, you know what I mean? I showed him love. I showed him a whole lot of love.
You did.
And I tell you, this guy, if he hadn't done that pro bono, he'd have had a problem with you.
he'd have had a real problem.
I'm gonna tell you that right now.
What about Goldust?
Goldie, that's my dog, man. Goldie, I say Goldie, I'm gonna be on the strip, man, doing some stuff, man. Charity, it's all about, you know, giving back. And it's, man, what time do you want me to show up? You know, and I swear, man,
he was the first one there.
Yeah,
right?
And he must have called me about 10 times, man. Where you at, man? Where you guys? I don't know where it's at. You know, I'm like, man, did you get an Uber or something to drop you off? I'm like, no, I got a car. You know, I'm like, you tripping, man. You know, but yeah, man, that's my boy, former tag team champions, Goldust and I, as well. RVD, former tag team champions, Goldust and I. And as well as, you know, this other guy that's going to be there, he's a
former WCW champion.
Former WCW champion, as well as a All-American, you know, a gold medalist. This man, Kurt Angle.
Oh, Kurt Angle, yeah. Kurt Angle.
I call him Curtis.
Curtis. Curtis Angle.
Yeah, I don't call him Kurt, you know what I mean?
Yeah.
Most people call him that, you know, and every time. I wonder, you know, what does he think of me?
Will you call him Curtis?
Because I think this is father. You know, I'm sure that's what it is.
Curtis,
you know, pick up your plate.
Did you finish the broccoli?
You know.
You don't even say so, broccoli. It's broccoli.
Yeah, Curtis Angle, yeah, he's going to be there as well. You know, and Kurt Angle, you know, one of our famous stories, you know, one of the famous matches that him and I had that, you know, we never got a chance to finish. And it will go down in the, you know, history and the annals of time. That match, you know, that never was.
Yeah, you're gonna hear that story, and you're gonna hear from former WCW champion, movie star, Hollywood elite.
Yeah,
David Arquette. David Arquette was there as well. He made a surprise. You know, he wasn't even scheduled to be on the show.
You know,
he just showed up.
Ready to Rumble. One of the best lines he had was, I will bust you. I loved it, man. I had so much fun on that set, man, Ready to Rumble with David Arquette. That was the first introduction for me as far as David Arquette goes. And, you know, he was just one of the boys, you know. he wasn't one, like, you know, wanting to be a superstar, you know, actor, you know, wanting to be, you know, A-list, you know, guy that, you know, want to have his own trailer. He just wanted to kick it, you know, have fun. He was always laughing. That's what I liked about David Arquette and the story of him winning the championship. Oh, man, that's another story. Guys, stick around. Heed the conversation. Back in a minute.
Shall not fear no man but God, though I walk through the valley of death.
Before I wait,
please God, walk with me
and take me to heaven.
Back in elementary.
Welcome back to Heated Conversations right here on Sports Radio 610. Hey guys, we play this one right here for one of our lost soldiers that we lost just this past Monday. One of the greats, one of the biggest, one of the best big men in the business, Big Van Vader, passed away at the age of 63 of congestive heart failure. And I tell you, he was definitely groundbreaking. Let's say that. I remember doing a photo shoot with Big Van Vader one time. And Big Van Vader, he was standing next to me, but he was standing like a foot in front of me. You know, he was still to the side, but he was a foot in front of me. And then I would move up to the side of Big Van Vader, and then he goes, "No, brother, you stay right there." And then I go, "You know, okay." He goes, "It's business, brother." And I go, "Oh, okay."
And I got to look bigger than you in the promos. Photo shoot, I got to look like the big guy.
I got to make myself look really big. That's Big Van Vader, man. You know what I mean? He taught me something. You know what I mean? Immediately, that was a lesson for me. And I knew from that point on, you know, I could make myself look actually bigger just by standing slightly in front of the guy that's standing next to me on camera. And I go, and then even more than that, only shoot us waist up, brother. Oh, my goodness. You know what I mean? So Big Van Vader, man, definitely one of the true greats. Three-time WCW champion, three-time IWGP champion. Definitely made his mark pretty much in Japan. Japan is the time and the spot where he got the big mastodon, you know, helmet. That's when we really became the fan of Leon Baby Bull White. You know what I mean? Because before that, you know, he didn't get that kind of fanfare. But after he put that mask on, it wasn't even a mask. It was that helmet that he came out with. Then it would shoot smoke out of it.
Yeah.
And then, you know, when he took it off, you know, he had the mask on, of course. But for a big man, he went out and moved like a guy much smaller than he did. He went out there and did moves like a guy much smaller than himself would do, you know. So I tell you, Big Van Vader, you know, hopefully he's in a better place, man. Definitely, the thing is, to the end, you know, that's the thing, you know, you never know how you're going to handle life, you know, when it's your time, when you feel it coming. But Vader was still out there doing shows.
Yeah.
He was still out there wrestling. He was like, "Man, you know, I ain't going to stop until it's time for me to stop." And, you know, that's the only way, I think, to be able to live life, you know, is be able to look at it and straight in the eye and say, you know, "Come and get me, man. Here I come," you know. And, you know, and know that, you know, if you're a God-fearing man, you know, like I am, you know you're going to a better place.
Vader was always one of the guys when I was a kid, though, who— like, there are very few people who just kind of scared you when you looked at them, especially as a kid. And I wasn't even as afraid of The Undertaker as I was afraid of Big Van Vader. I thought that he was going to jump through that television screen and Vader bomb me in my living room. He just had that. He felt wild.
You think Mike,
he felt unchained.
You think Mike Tyson got some off-the-chain interviews? Go and look at some of Big Van Vader's stuff. And it's real.
It's Vader time.
I mean, it was real back then. Like I say, those guys, man, those rookies, you know, back in the locker room when, you know, guys like Big Sid Vicious, you know, Sid Vicious, man, back then, man, he really did think he ruled the world. He jived. And Big Van Vader, you know, that was like his sign. They were like superheroes running around. Yeah. And they thought they were superheroes in their own minds, you know, at the same time, too. You know, so those guys, those young rookies, man, they would be sitting in the locker room and, you know, Vader would come in and, you know, Vader would go, I'll take him. You know, and see it come in and go, I want him. You know, and those guys, man, oh, God, those other guys over there in the corner, they're like, God, thank God, oh, God.
Oh, he didn't pick me.
And, you know, they survived that week. Yeah. But the next week, there is to come. You know what I mean? So I tell you, man, so many stories about Big Van.
Your first pay-per-view in Houston was with Vader, right? Yeah, you were on his team in the War Games.
I was in the main event, man. I mean, I was a young green kid, man, and I tell you, this was crazy. This is a story of Big Van Vader. He, you know, had been around much longer than I have, of course. You know, he did his tour in Japan and then coming back to WCW. That was like, you know, easy money for him, you know. But myself, I was a green kid coming in that Vader didn't know from, you know, a hole in the ground, you know. So my thing was, let me get to know Mr. Vader. How you doing, Mr. Vader? You know, knowing that I'm going into this big match, War Games, you know what I mean? All the major players, Big Sid Vicious, Big Van Vader.
British Bulldog, you know, Sting.
Yeah, you know, man, it was crazy, you know, Dustin Rhodes, you know.
Shockmaster.
It was nuts, man. You know, and I'm like, Vader, you know, what do you want me to do in this match? You know, and he goes, you know, you think you ready for this, kid? You know? And I go, yeah, I'm ready for this. My whole attitude changed. Yeah. You know, I've been training for this. You know, I work with guys like, you know, Black Bart. You know, I got work with guys like Johnny Mantell, you know what I mean? Hollywood John Tatum, you know, Manny Fernandez. I've been training for this moment. I just need to know, what do you need me to do? And he said, just bump, kid.
Just listen to me and bump.
Oh, how sweet it is, man. How sweet it is. Boom. Hopefully it's in a better place, man. Most deaf, man. Most deaf. Big ups. Hey, man, moving on. Still in the wrestling world, man. The wrestling world. Let's talk about it. We might as well talk about it. Big Cass.
Yeah. Big Cass got his release from WWE after 7 years under contract.
Enzo 6 months earlier.
Enzo in January got his release.
Big Cass get his. So many rumors flying around, man, as far as, you know, I think, you know, the story, of course, is Big Cass, but I think the story is bigger than Big Cass. I really do, you know, because just say, for instance, back in the day, you know, you didn't tell anyone who you voted for.
Right.
You know what I mean? It was a secret. You know,
you don't talk about religion and politics.
You don't bring stuff like that together.
Don't bring it up.
But because we got to be friends and we don't want to even have to. That's something that you got to deal with inside yourself. You know, it's just like, you know, I have nothing. I'm not homophobic or anything like that. But when gay people come out, I'd be like, man, you didn't have to tell me that because I'm going to still give you a hug.
It's cool with me.
No matter what. Yeah. I don't. It's not my business. You know, so when people do certain things, they literally become vulnerable and not really keep their eye on the prize as far as what's really at stake here. You know, my livelihood, you know. It's all about, at the end of the day, I think, taking care of your family. You know, going out, doing the work, and taking care of your family. Going out and doing the job, like my brother said, you know, Stevie Ray, to the best of your ability, to something better come along. Yeah. You know, and I say that because it's very, very simple. You know, we are all in the entertainment business. If you want to be, running a publication, you know, do that over there. Get another job, you know. But Twitter, you know, that right there can ruin one's life. You know, going on Twitter saying something.
I mean, Roseanne Barr whole show.
Lost all millions and millions of dollars.
Yeah.
Over saying something stupid, man. And there again, that's her right. That's her belief. she can do that. But then there is consequences and repercussions. And in 2018, if people don't understand the smallest little bitty things, you know, what do they say? Mountain out of a molehill.
Yeah.
You know, that's what could happen. You know, so big cast there again. I like the guy. I never knew anything about his, you know, beliefs as was the Trump thing or anything.
And to let people know who are listening, the rumor was that the big cast wasn't so well liked by some of his cohorts because he was very, very outspoken about his support for the president, Donald Trump.
Maybe that was part of it, but my thing is this here.
That was a rumor.
My thing is this. This is what I've always said. And I've been one of the boys. You know, I had to work in that locker room, you know. Mm-hmm. I might have had heat with some of the boys, you know, at certain times, you know, throughout my career, you know. But if I went out and performed in the ring, all of that, you know, overshadowed and trumped everything else, you know, your performance, you know, if you're on time, if you, you know, ready to go as far as, you know, guys need you for a promo seg, they're not looking all over for you. Hey, Book, I need you to go, do a tour for me on sale this week. Oh, man, I'm going to be, you know, I had a party going on or something this week. You know, everything comes into play as far as being around or not, being a general or being a private. You know, I want to be a general, so I'm going to always be on time. I'm always had a haircut, you know what I mean? I had shoes spit shine. You know what I mean? The tie is going to be right. All of the metals is going to be straight. You know what I mean? The bed, you know what I mean? Everything's tucked. You know what I mean? And when you don't take care of your business, this is what could happen to you. When you go out there thinking that, I talk to my young guys at Reality of Wrestling all the time at the end of the night. We have a conversation. And my point, just about every month, almost just about every month, that it's never about them. It's always about the show. At the end of the day, if you go out and just do your part and the next guy do his part, so forth, so on, at the end of the day, we'll have a great show. And next month, it'll be more fans here to watch you guys. And some people just don't get that.
Yeah, and I think... Also, though, so to go back to the big cast thing, do you think, though, him being out, do you think that was the only factor that came into play was the fact that he was outspoken about his politics? Because that doesn't sound, hold on, I've never been in the locker room. I don't know how it is back there, but I think that just kind of sounds crazy to me.
The thing is, it could be a bunch of things.
It's a contributing factor, maybe.
But my point is this, when it get to that point, it ain't something that everybody else is doing. It's something that you're doing. It really is. You know, I've been around for many, many years in the business, and I knew as long as I went out and performed and thought about that, you know, I never had me and Charmelle, we got married. I can say that. But it was in the twilight of my career. I was literally almost 40, me and Charmelle, that was the first woman I ever, you know, thought about talking to. And if you, you know, listen to Charmelle, she thought I hated her the first time, you know, we met.
Cause you were all business.
I was always all business. You know, when I was in my 20s, you know, and in my 30s, I was thinking about, you know, man, I gotta make my mark and I gotta do it now. I can't, you know, get married or anything like that and let that slow me down with one of the women that I got to work with, because I know exactly where that's going to lead, you know. So I was always thinking about going out there and performing and that only. And I just think these young guys, you know, they it's easy to get caught up. You know, it's easy to, easy access. But when you lose focus, you know, when you lose your train of thought for 1 second, when you take those blinders off, you know, anything could happen, man. When you start thinking it's a party, you know, opposed to you putting your suit and tie on and you going to work and you're going to go out there and get your job done and get back home and take care of more business, you're thinking about the wrong thing. So, hey, big ups to Big Cass, man. Hopefully he'll find something. It's a lot of work still out there on the scenes, independent world, Japan, you know, the ROH, you know what I mean? But I tell you, man, he definitely, whatever he did, he definitely lost out on this deal, because I thought Big Cass could have been one of the next great big men. You know, we talk about Big Van Vader, one of the great big men, you know, of the sport. Guys, stick around. Back in a minute.
I'm a 713.
Houston got about four different area codes.
Yeah, we got 346.
I used to be a 713, but you know, yeah. That's in the hood.
I'm a 713.
Yeah.
Mobile is 713.
Oh, okay. I'm like, but you can't be 713. You are. I mean, come on.
Yeah.
You're kidding me.
Did you hear this new Beyonce Jay-Z album? They released a surprise album.
It's like a family deal, right? It's like a little family.
It's called Everything Is Love.
Yeah. Hey, man. More power to him. You know, like Pac said, you know, anybody get money? He didn't use that term. But I'm all for him. You know what I mean? I'm all for him. You know what I mean? Seriously, for them to be that power couple and keep it in the family, be able to release stuff like that and have enough of a following to where, boom, they make instant cash off of it. And give the world what they want without the middleman messing everything up. That's really, truly the American way, I think. You know what I mean? If every artist could go out there and pull that off, you know, you got guys like Drake. They could do that.
Yeah.
You know what I mean? You got certain artists that can go out there and pull something off like that. But if the world become, you know, that, you know, these young cats really can really put themselves in a good position going forward, because we've heard about the record contracts. I mean, this heated conversation. We talk about sports and stuff on him, but I know a little bit about music. But those contracts that those artists would sign would be, you know, penny on the dollar.
Yeah.
You know, and you know, sometimes you got to split that penny three ways or five ways. I'm serious. You know what I mean? And as, you know, I tell you, man, and this LaFace, you know what I mean? I've heard some of the stuff about that.
Yeah.
Man, I tell you, man, this is truly the way of the future, man. And it all comes from the social media world, man. Without that social media world, this would not be happening with Beyonce and Jay-Z. Big ups, big ups, big ups. You know, you like
the,
you know,
I like the Carters. I might have to go, they're going to be here in September. I might go check that one out.
Yeah, you know, yeah, they're going to be here. Somebody else is going to be here I want to go see, man. Can't remember who it was. Oh, yeah, Breezy, Chris Breezy. Make sure you play me some Breezy, man, before we get up out of here today. Chris Brown going to be here in town. I want to go check that out.
Yeah, his last album had 47 songs on it.
Wow. I'm going to tell you, man.
That's too many.
No, I'm going to tell you, Chris Brown is the hardest working son of a gun out there, man. That boy works. As well as, he's better than all them suckers. You know? Tell me who better than Chris Brown. Chris Brown.
Beyonce?
No, I'm talking about male on
male?
The male side. Yeah.
Like male R&B?
Yeah, male R&B. I mean, he do a little bit of rap, too. He do a little bit of everything.
Yeah.
But tell me who better than C. Breezy.
Yeah, it's a good question, because he is a raw, talented guy. Nah. There's some new guys out there, like cats, like, you know, Black.
I mean,
and
who's
Miguel
a better? I mean, we could talk. I mean, we could have a debate about who's a better dancer than Breezy.
Yeah, I don't think there is one as far as the male.
You
the
see,
males
you
go.
See what that boy do to Usher?
Yeah,
He made him look. He made him look bad. He made him look old. You know what I mean? I was like, man, Usher, come on, dog. You got a little bit more than that, Breezy just shut him down. I'm serious, man. That boy, man. Who better right now in 2018 than Chris Brown?
I don't know, man. Chris Brown, he the man, man.
Let me tell you something. My nephews right now, they like 30, you know, and you know, mid 30, yeah, 31, 32. Yeah, my son's 33. And we were having this conversation literally about 15 years ago when Chris Brown was just first jumping on the scene,
yeah,
young kid, and they was having a debate at my house, you know, at one of the family functions, and they asked me, Unc, what do you think about Chris Brown? I swear to God,
yeah,
this is a true story. And I say, man, I really think this guy's going to be the future of music. I say, I think Chris Brown is really that good. And that's when he was a kid. And now, this many years later, Chris Brown, hey, man, he's taking over the game, man. He's taking over the game as far as me. Everything Chris Brown put out, I mean, you don't even hear half the stuff that he put out because most of it is overseas.
He's a hardworking guy.
They're eating it up over there.
Yeah. Wow.
I'm just saying, man. Hey, man, let's round this thing up.
Somebody's got to like him.
Let's move on. We're going to be talking about a little bit of UFC. You know, UFC going to be going down. UFC 226. I'm definitely going to give my prediction as far as Stipe Miocic versus DC Daniel Cormier.
Heavyweight title, baby.
You know, DC moving up from light heavy to heavyweight. DC never losing a heavyweight bout as well. This is going to be good. It's going to be intriguing. We're going to talk about that. But let's move back to WWE for a second. Money in the Bank coming up. I can't wait to be there. I'm going to be there. I'm looking forward to it. Got me a nice new suit with a flower in the lapel. Mm-hmm. What you guys?
Money in the Bank just happened.
Oh, I'm sorry. Money in the Bank just happened.
You're thinking SummerSlam or Extreme Rules.
But I'm thinking Money in the Bank, Braun Strowman's win. That's what I'm thinking about. I'm thinking about Braun Strowman's big win, as well as I'm thinking about the rumor of Brock Lesnar and Bobby Lashley. I was looking at something on e-wrestling news, give him a plug, and they was talking about Brock Lesnar versus Bobby Lashley. Now, this is a match we've been wanting to see it in the MMA world for quite some time. You know, Bobby Lashley has talked about it, you know, facing the beast incarnate, Brock Lesnar. Me personally, it's a lot of speculation, but I don't think, honestly, I don't think Bobby Lashley is ready for this competition. Just, I think he should have a few more matches under his. Look here, the Sami Zayn thing. Come on.
It's over with. You know, he came out victorious. I think there's a fatal five-way going down Extreme Rules to determine who gets the shot at Brock, but the favorite right now is Bobby Lashley.
Well, my thing is this. I think Bobby Lashley, if in my opinion, he should want to lay out on something. Like, I know it's something, you know, intriguing and say, hey, man, let me get in there. But have you seen what Brock Lesnar do to people? Have you seen it?
He's pretty impressive.
I mean, come on. Did you see John Cena get split open? Did you see Braun Strowman get checked?
Yeah.
You know, so Bobby just got back. You know, Bobby's back, you know, to dominate. That's what the T-shirt says. Back to dominate. Work with some of those underneath guys first, man. You know, some of the jabronis.
So you don't think that, would you not like to see Bobby Lashley versus Brock Lesnar? Because I think on paper it's really intriguing, because if you look at their trajectory in their careers, both when they first came into WWE, made a big splash. Bobby Lashley was, I think, ECW champion. Brock Lesnar, WWE champion. Then they both step aside. They both go into MMA. And then they both come back to WWE. You know, Brock went to Japan. Bobby went to TNA.
You remember, I told a story right here on the show. I'm the one who told Bobby Lashley he was Brock Lesnar, you know, at one point, and he didn't believe me, you know, and he had to go and find himself. So, look, I know all about Bobby Lashley. Look, I have a piece in training Bobby Lashley, right here at my school, right here in Houston, Texas. I'm the guy that put the polish on Bobby Lashley as far as his wrestling career, as far as the show business, as far as the Shakespeare's Romeo and Juliet, you know, his Phantom of the Opera. I did that. You know what I mean? But so I got a little bit invested going into this match. And right now, I just think Bobby Lashley need to, you know, come back, work a few matches. You know, I mean, if he's going to get the title put on him or something like that, that's another story. You know what I mean? But, you know, me personally, you know, get a few more. Get your legs under you a little bit. You know, right now, a couple of matches, running on lazy legs. You know, I'm just saying.
Well, you know, but if it, let's just say that rumors are what they are, but this, there's another rumor that's like, well, this could be Brock's last match in WWE before he goes back to the Octagon. Would you like to see Brock Lesnar's last match in WWE be against Bobby Lashley?
You know, my thing is this. I don't believe that rumor.
Okay.
First and foremost. Brock Lesnar just signed a contract with the WWE. I don't think it was a 3-month deal.
They said it was short term, whatever that means.
I mean, but Brock Lesnar, you know, going back to the UFC, why? Just, I mean, it would be some good money, perhaps, you know what I mean, to go back. But who's there to fight in the heavyweight division right now? I mean,
Stipe, DC.
I mean, come on.
John Jones.
I mean, I don't even know if he's still suspended, isn't he?
John Jones?
No.
Or Brock?
Brock Lesnar.
I don't know what the situation is because Dana White has said, yeah, he's coming back in 2018. You're going to see Brock
fight. Well, I mean.
I don't know how they pull it off.
From what we know, it was a suspension.
And then he retired. So I don't know. When you retire, do they wipe the suspension away?
If you retire, do that make a prison sentence go away?
Well, no, but this isn't a prison sentence. This is USADA. This is a commission.
I mean, what's this guy thinking? I mean, come on, man. What do you think?
Well, no, but I'm saying, okay, so you're in MMA. They suspend you for a year, and you say, you know what? Screw that. I'm retired.
I think the retirement, the suspension stops right there.
And then it picks back up.
When you come back, it picks up exactly where you retired from. That's the way it should be.
So I know that he appealed that suspension. I think he got it from 2 years to 1 year or something like that in a fine. He had to pay a percentage of his purse to Mark Hunt, if I do remember correctly. So we could still see maybe Brock back in early 2019 if he does go back to the UFC, which I would like to see him. I like him in the UFC.
A lot of people wishing and hoping, man. A lot of people wishing and hoping. I mean, my thing is...
You think he could take John Jones? You think he could take Stipe? You think he could take DC in the heavyweight division?
Well, the one thing that he will be taking is a huge risk. That's what he will be taking, you know. And the thing is Brock Lesnar capable of going over there and, you know, dominating, you know?
Absolutely.
Absolutely. But one thing I do know about the fight game, man, I do know in that game, the longer you do it, the more your skill deteriorate. No matter how much your brain feel like you could actually go out there and still be the same guy, your body is going to tell you something different. Time off is one's worst enemy, being away from the sport and just jumping. And the thing is, for me, I like Brock Lesnar. Brock Lesnar's a good friend of mine. I think it's dangerous, you know, jumping in and out like that. You know what I mean? I don't know if he's going to go back or not. We'll find out. We'll find out very, very soon because, you know, contract, you know, what, this short-term deal?
That's what they say.
You know.
They say it could just be one more match, and then he's out. Yeah, Bobby Lashley, Brock Lesnar, Universal title at SummerSlam. That's a prediction of mine.
All right, whatever, man.
I like to see it.
Whatever. Hey, man, I want a big shout-out to my niece, Tiara. It's her 24th birthday today. I just stopped by, you know, hung out for a minute. But happy birthday, kid. Many, many more. It seems just like yesterday you was... 7-8 years old, just like little Kennedy Rose and Kendrick James, man. I remember Kennedy, you know, our first time, you know, being at my sister's house, you know. Kennedy was probably 2 years old. I went somewhere, came back. Ah, she was like, you know, all over me. And it seemed like just yesterday. And now they're almost 8 years old, man. Time flies. Hug your kids, man. Hear the conversation. Back in a minute. Yeah,
words. You ain't nothing but a vulture.
I like this song.
Welcome back to Heated Conversations on Sports Radio 610. You know, and the thing is, he ain't got like that Teddy Pendergrass, you know, voice and that.
Oh, no.
His voice is totally different. It's unique. It's breezy, but he's the best thing going today. To be the man, you got to beat the man. So Rick Flair used to say, right?
Right.
Hey man, talk a little UFC, man. UFC coming up. Hey, before we even get started with, you know, Stipe and DC going down, I want to clear a couple of things up.
What's that?
First and foremost, I want to clear a couple, you know, because people have been, you know, beating me up on Twitter. Talk. What?
No. Go ahead.
Yeah.
Go ahead.
People have been beating me up on Twitter, you know, saying, you know, why am I throwing shade on CM Punk? And the thing is.
And what they're referring to is this. Ed, can you play that? Can you play that clip for us? I want to hear the clip.
Hey, no, don't play that. Ed, don't play that. Don't play it. No, I don't want to hear that. You know, I don't want.
So the fans know what you're talking about.
No, I don't want to indulge in that.
Okay.
I don't want to indulge in that.
Never mind, Ed.
Yeah, that's not where I'm trying to go here. What I'm trying to go here is serious. I'm trying to be serious here. I'm not here to throw shade on CM Punk or anything like that. I like CM Punk as a person, first and foremost. You know, people talk about, you know, I had him here at Reality of Wrestling.
In the PWA days, yeah.
And, you know, I was one of the first supporters of CM Punk. When CM Punk, you know, came up in the WWE, you know, I was one of the guys who was having matches with CM Punk. I'm one of the guys who had to go out and put CM Punk over in certain matches and didn't mind doing it.
Like 05, 06 era.
Yes, I go back and look at your research, guys. Go back and look at it. Pull them up, pull the matches up. Booker T, CM Punk. I put this guy over.
And you didn't have a problem with it.
Heck no. I mean, because I saw a young kid coming up, a young kid on the rise. When CM Punk was doing it, I was like I say, one of his biggest supporters. When CM Punk was, you know, got the big contract, you know, boom, I was like, man, this guy's, you know, moving to the next level. You know, when CM Punk left the WWE, I was stunned because I was like, man, this guy's walking away from, you know, like I said, I don't know the backstory or anything like that. I'm talking about from the outside looking in.
Just the money he was walking away from.
Well, the money he was walking, I mean, you know, when you see a guy riding in one of those big buses, you know, only certain guys have those buses. And those guys are making a lot of money, you know.
The Cenas, the Ortons.
Yeah, man, those guys, you know, and I mean, they pay to, you know, ride like that. Mm-hmm. But those guys are making a lot of money, and CM Punk, he's one of those guys. And then to see him walk away from that to go in, you know, to the UFC to go and, you know, have a real fight. And me personally, I know what the fight game is all about. I've been watching fighting my whole life. That's I've been a part of, you know, combat, you know, trying to make it through this life, you know, myself, you know what I mean? So seeing what CM Punk was walking into, I thought it was something, you know, he was getting in way in over his head and walking away from something that perhaps he may never be able to walk back to. So when he did that, I was like, man, this is something. Can you imagine one day waking up and wanting to be an Olympic athlete, and you knew the president of, you know, the commission, and he put you in a race, you know, yeah, in the 100-yard dash, and you're going against, you know, Carl Lewis and Ben Johnson and
Usain
all the rest
Bolt
of them. Usain Bolt.
Jesse Owens,
exactly. Yeah. That's my point, guys. I'm saying this guy was putting himself in a position that perhaps he was in way over his head. Maybe someone should have told him that. So I'm not throwing shade on CM Punk or anything like that. I just think the decision that CM Punk made was a really, truly bad decision and a bad mistake for CM Punk's career, because this guy could have been one of the all, maybe he didn't want to be one of the all-time greats. I'm just saying
he could have
been one of the all-time greats of our sport, of our business, professional wrestling. That's my point, guys. That's the ultimate point coming from Booker T about CM Punk. All right? I like the guy. I just think he walked away from something that he could have been such a huge part of.
And I think it's kind of, it's unfair, some of the criticism that mainly you, but both of us have received when covering CM Punk, because we're treating him in the octagon and in UFC as an equal, right? We're not
I'm treating CM Punk like I don't know him.
Right.
Like he's
like
a
he's like, a fighter.
Like he's a fighter. Like, I mean, and I should cover it that way. I mean, I hear a lot of guys saying he had a lot of heart and this and that and whatnot. But those guys wasn't in CM Punk's place. Everywhere CM Punk walked, he walked like a god. And the thing is, Tiger Woods at one point, everywhere he walked like a god until his situation happened. Two totally different situations, but a situation is what I'm talking about. CM Punk had the wrestling world in the palm of his hand, and he walked away from it to go to the UFC. I just think that was a bad decision. That's just me.
Yeah, and I agree. And once again, not that we need to defend or you need to defend any comments that you make, but, you know, you're covering a guy that you know, but you're doing objectively, and you're actually looking at the whole of the sport and not an isolated fight, right? You're not looking at this isolated experiment of CM Punk. You're looking at, hey, this guy named CM Punk fought this guy named Mike Jackson. This is what happened. He went out there and he got the brakes beat off him. That's a fact.
Yeah, it is a
fact. Someone tell me that's not a fact.
It is a fact.
That's exactly what happened. You were in Chicago in Money in the Bank, and you were talking about Ronda coming in from UFC to wrestling. So a logical comparative would be someone going from wrestling to UFC.
Well,
it was a fact.
I'm doing my job.
It was a fact.
The thing is, that's all I'm doing is doing my job. And the thing is, I would be, you know, if I wasn't there to actually, you know, create, you know, talk, that's something that perhaps I wouldn't talk about. But I am trying to create talk. I am trying to create conversation. I am trying to keep our show entertaining. And my thing is, it's news. And if it was anybody else, if it was, you know, Charlie Punk, if it was, you know, I'm serious. I mean, if it was anyone, I would have made that same comparison, because, like I say, I cannot think for one moment, you know, that I could get up and, you know, go and fight, you know, Evander Holyfield. Evander Holyfield right now is, you know, 50 something years old. I wouldn't wake up, you know, in my 20s, you know, saying, man, I want to fight Evander Holyfield, and he's in his 50s, because that would be an unfair advantage for Evander Holyfield. I've never had a fight. I'm fighting a guy who was a professional. I don't care if he's 50 years old. He still was a professional, you know. And let's make this comparison right here. Randy Couture versus James Toney. If Randy Couture fought James Toney inside of a boxing ring, James Toney would knock him out 10 times out of 10 times, 20 times out of 20 times.
Look at Floyd
times.
And Connor.
I mean, go in, you know, do some history on this stuff. And that's what I'm talking about, the fight game. I'm a true, loyalist to the art of the pugilism. I'm a loyalist, you know what I mean? And when I see something like that happen, you know, and like I say, sometimes, you know, like in a fight, you know, a fighter has to be saved from himself.
Yeah.
And I just think in this situation,
towel needs to be thrown in.
No, not the towel should be thrown in. I just think someone should have advised him going into this. Hey, man, this is not a good idea. You know, fighting is something that's very, very serious. The true art of war, you know. I mean, I go back to the Bruce Lee days, man, and the Chuck Norris. You know what I'm saying? You know,
old school.
That's old school, but it's real. You know what I mean? As far as, you know, the philosophy of what the fight game truly embodies. You know what I mean? And you don't wake up one day being the best fighter. Muhammad Ali didn't wake up the greatest of all time. He became the greatest of all time. He worked at his craft at becoming the greatest of all time. It didn't just happen overnight.
But he also worked at it from a young age and dedicated his entire life to it.
Yeah.
He didn't have another career prior to, and then just decided to jump into boxing. I mean, this is what he worked for his entire life. You said just a second ago, CM Punk could have been an all-time great in professional wrestling because he had worked at it his entire life.
Yeah, I mean, he was on the independent scene. Everybody loved him.
Since 98
even now, his name rings, you know, in arenas, you know. So that's my point right there. I mean, I don't want to hear people talking about me throwing shade on CM Punk. Do people pay me to say stuff about? Now,
I saw those comments. That's
not
ridiculous.
That's not it at all. Like I say, I just think the guy walked away from so much. He could have been so much. But then again, maybe he didn't want that. And that's just, you know, that's just me saying that, because maybe it is what it is. You know what I mean? And that's another story. You know, that's something that we could debate. You know, that's something him and I could debate, you know, because I love to talk to CM Punk and get his perspective on, you know, what he was thinking about going into something like this, making this kind of move. Did he think? Sometimes I talk to my wrestlers all the time. I talk to my students and I say, you got to know how good you really are, you know. You got to be able to look in the mirror, you know, and know if you could stand next to, you know, a John Cena, a Randy Orton, you know, those you know, big money players like Roman Reigns. I say you got to know if you could stand next to these guys, you know, and maybe he actually thought that, you know what I mean? Maybe, you know, doing a few jiu-jitsu classes, you know, and you take a few guys down and, you know, I mean, one day, I was in the wrestling school back when we were downtown, and I ran the gauntlet. I may have choked out five guys in a row.
Yeah, and what it is, it's like a shoot night where y'all get in the ring and you go at it for real.
Yeah, and it was a shoot night. You know, it was you know, I still had my wings. You know what I mean? I still, you know, wanted to show how tough I was to the guys. So I say, let me go out here and, you know, see what these guys got. You know what I mean? So one after another, you know, bing, give me another. You know what I mean? Bing, give me another. You know what I mean? Bing, give me another. You know, bing, give me another. You know what I mean? Finally, I got to the last guy, you know, worked with him a little bit. He was a little tougher, but boom, got him in that anaconda choke. You know what I mean? Not anaconda choke.
Yeah. Same as CM Punk still.
I'm thinking about CM Punk.
Anaconda vice. So you got all fired up, and you can't get them off your mind.
No, but it was an anaconda joke.
Okay.
But got him out of there. But you think I could do that to one of those guys in the UFC?
Absolutely
not.
You
know, block that. Next thing, you know, I'm on my back, you know, tapping because my ankle is broken.
Well, we talked about it, too, with, you know, the rumor. Even a guy who's the caliber of Mike Jackson, who we would say, and all due respect to him, is a lower caliber fighter. You know, a guy who's only had two professional fights. But done boxing, kickboxing. But we talked about it last week when Daniel Bryan made that challenge of, you know, he wanted to fight him. It's just not a good idea.
It's not wise. And, you know, that's what I told Daniel. I said, Daniel, come on, man.
You talked to him at Money in the Bank.
I talked to Daniel about it. He said, you know, he would be willing to do it. You know what I mean? Because that's the type of guy he is. He don't mind getting into a fight. Daniel Bryan's the type of guy who's actually rolled around and, you know, he loved the art of, you know, pugilism. I respect that, you know, but I say, come on, man. You know, I mean, Mike Jackson said it on the show, you know, you got issues. I know exactly about his issues. And the world knows. Stick to your moneymaker, Total Bellas.
Oh, hey. Come on now. Come on now.
I'm just playing.
I know it.
I'm just playing. I told him, stick to your moneymaker, man. You know, go out there and do your thing. And forget that, man. Forget all about that. Because that ain't happening, bro. You know, so...
this isn't the one.
No, I'm serious. You know what I mean? Hopefully he listened to me. But he's just one of those type of guys, man, that just don't mind getting...
He seems like he likes a challenge.
He loves a challenge.
Yeah.
You know what I mean? Coming off a broken neck and getting back into square circle, that 20 by 20, I respect him, man. I saw him do that drop kick again just last week. I don't like it. Hey, guys, stick around. Heat the conversation. Back in a minute. Boom, 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 boom. Now tell me what you're gonna do, but it ain't nowhere to run. When judgment comes for you, when judgment comes for you. Tell me what you're gonna do, when it ain't nowhere to hide. When judgment comes for you, cause it's gonna come. Man up! That's what you better do, man. Heated Conversation, Sports Radio 610. Bone Thugs and Harmony. Them boys right there, man. They were so fresh and smooth. You know, Crazy Bone, Lazy Bone, Flesh Wish. You know what I mean?
You gotta love how dedicated they were. Do you think they had to like draw short straws on who got what name? Because I wouldn't want to walk around being flesh and bone for the rest of my life. Or wishbone.
Lazy.
Crazy.
Them boys was bad.
It's pretty creative.
I'm serious, man. Them boys was bad, man.
Bone's a good one.
No, I'm serious, though. As far as groups go, rap groups, I put Bone against any of them, man.
They're up there.
I'm serious.
They're up there.
Bone was bad, man.
I think they're in the top five,
yeah,
for sure.
Yeah, most
definitely. Run DMC, Outkast, UGK.
Bone didn't get that fanfare like those guys did.
Yeah.
Because they was a dysfunctional family.
A little bit.
You got to say that.
You know,
Run and J and D, them boys knew they had to stay together to make that Peppa, baby. That's what it was all about. But moving on. Dwight Howard.
Dwight, man.
Dwight Howard.
Friend of the show.
You know, he used to be a friend of the show when he was in Houston.
Yeah.
You know, I got the only interview in Houston from Dwight Howard in studio.
Yeah.
You know, he's a big fan. I like Dwight Howard. You know, he's a good guy.
Yeah.
We
went to his birthday party.
And it was awesome. It was awesome.
Some like chateau or whatever.
Yeah. It was an awesome night. But the thing is, man, the question I asked Dwight Howard right here in studio was, do you consider basketball your job or a game? And he goes, it's a game. And I was taken aback by that right there, you know, because I don't think all the true greats, the Moses Malones, the Michael Jordans, the Charles Barkleys of the world, you know what I mean? The LeBron James,
Shaq Diesel,
the Steph Currys.
Yeah.
You know, I don't think these guys look at it like a game, because they want to win, man. They want that trophy. They want that ring. They want that adulation. They want to be recognized. And I don't think losing, at the end of the day, that happens for you.
Dwight Howard, to be on four different teams now over the last four NBA seasons, going from Houston to Atlanta to Charlotte, and now he's going to the Brooklyn Nets.
To be such an awesome, awesome big man.
Eight-time All-Star.
That guy looked like he can do anything, man, but play with other guys. I'm serious. That seemed like his biggest problem. But I tell you what, man, 2K19 is happy. They got another character to work with. They're keeping them boys in business.
But here's the thing. Here's my thing about Dwight Howard. I know he's on the latter portion of his career, and he yields a pretty high salary. But in Brooklyn, I don't know. I think that's kind of a good piece. I think it's a good piece for Brooklyn. I think it's a good pickup, especially after this year's up. Maybe they can renegotiate for a little less money. And I think Dwight is still a piece. I really do. I think he could be a valuable member of a team, but it has to be the right team, and he can't be the star.
Look,
he's got to be second, third option on a team for them to be successful. That was what his falling out was here in Houston. He wanted to be first option, and we had James Harden. That was the only bad thing, was he couldn't be the first option here. So he thought he'd be the first option in Atlanta. Didn't really work out for him there. And for Charlotte to trade you, for Charlotte, who needs a star on that team. The biggest star of the team is the owner, and that's Michael Jordan. But you don't have any stars on that team. You have a guy like Dwight, who's a household name, and then you trade him off to the Brooklyn Nets for remember who they got for him, but it wasn't really anything.
You got all these analogies. Let me enlighten you, okay? Let me enlighten you and tell you exactly.
This coming from the guy who doesn't think James Harden's the MVP. Go ahead.
Let me tell you. It's true. let me tell you exactly what this is right here. Did you say that Dwight Howard is in the twilight of his career? Didn't you just say that?
Yeah, the latter portion of his career.
The latter part of his career.
Yeah.
Let me tell you what Brooklyn is. Brooklyn is like that town you see in those old cowboy movies with the skull and crossbones. When you ride in, it is the last stop.
That tumbleweed comes across the screen.
Exactly. That's what this is. Brooklyn is the final stop for Dwight Howard. That's what this winds up being at the end of the day. Okay, can we agree on that?
I'll agree with you on that.
So, I tell you, man, the dude has made a ton of money. You know, and this is true. This is true as well. Being able to do something you love to do and make a lot of money doing it throughout life, you know, that's the American dream right there. So, it hadn't been bad for Dwight Howard or anything like that, but I just think this guy could have gotten so much more out of his career. I just think a championship ring should be on the right hand of Dwight Howard. Well, my championship ring is on the left hand, but I mean, mine is on the right hand. The other championship ring is on the left hand. He should have had one, man. He should have got one ring.
Should have got one
in his career, I mean, man. And I do not think he's gonna get one in Brooklyn. Let's agree, I think that's safe to say.
To go from the Magic to the Lakers, and you're on the Lakers with Kobe Bryant and Steve Nash, and then you go to the Rockets, and then the Hawks, then the Hornets, then the Nets. I mean, it doesn't really speak well.
Yeah, when Kobe say, man, get rid of this guy. you know what I mean? One of the best big men in the sport.
Especially at that time.
Says something, man. It says something. You know, when you bounce around like that, it's normally not the team. You know, normally, you know. But the thing is also, we haven't heard a whole lot of controversy about Dwight Howard. Like he's a troubled teammate or anything like that.
Houston, we heard some of that, right? But not since. You know, in Houston, we definitely heard that he and James didn't get along. They didn't see eye to eye. We heard in the Lakers, he and Kobe didn't really see eye to eye. You talked about Kobe Bryant to him on the show. You know, I don't think that he's had too many issues in the Hawks and on the Hornets.
Yeah.
But, you know, I just really can't believe that Dwight Howard has been on six NBA teams. I think he should have never left the Magic. He should have just stayed with the Magic, but he saw that opportunity to go to L.A., just like his predecessor, Shaquille O'Neal, went from the Magic to the Lakers, won all the championships.
Look, man,
that's
not it, man. When you got to get traded because of this reason and that reason. We talked about that on the show. That's another story. Hey, man, Stipe Miocic, D.C. Cormier. Who you got?
Man, I got Stipe. I got Stipe Miocic. I know Daniel Cormier never lost a fight, like you said, in the heavyweight division. The only fights that he's lost have been both times to John Jones. I just think Stipe's on a crazy run. Think about this. Mark Hunt, Andre Arlovsky, Fabricio Verdum, Alistair Overeem, Junior Dos Santos, Francis Ngannou, all in a row. And now he's got DC. I'm telling you, if he does it, you're going to have to finally say Stipe Miocic is the greatest heavyweight in UFC history if he beats Daniel Cormier. I think there's no argument after that.
Well, okay. I tell you what. This is what I'll do. Because I said it, you know what I mean? He's not in my greatest, you know, UFC heavyweight champions of all time or anything like that. But this is what I'll do just for you. Just for you. I wouldn't do this for anyone else.
Well, I appreciate it.
If Stipe Miocic beats Daniel Cormier, I will admit that he is the greatest UFC heavyweight champion in the history of the sport.
Okay, I like it.
But I don't think he's going to beat DC. I got my money on DC. And the reason I got my money on DC is because DC is a hell of a wrestler. DC can tap him out. He can ground and pound him. He can stand up with him. And, you know, at DC at heavyweight, he ain't going to have to worry about the cheeseburgers or the donuts. You feel me?
I don't know. I think he's going to have to, not to make weight, but to be conditioned for this fight. He hasn't fought at heavyweight in a long, long, long time.
Yeah,
he doesn't remember how those extra loves on him is going to slow him down.
The thing is,
inside the octagon.
I would be worried if he had to come from heavyweight to light heavyweight. That would worry me. But going from light heavyweight to heavyweight is only a couple of extra pounds, actually. And DC, you know, he always walks around pretty much own weight. So he's not going to have to do anything in order to get ready to go out and perform other than get in the gym and train. That's it. That's it. I think he's in a better position at heavyweight. I think he's been fighting at light heavyweight because that's been the place to fight. That's where the money's at.
And you're right, but we're also looking at a Daniel Cormier who his last fight was his last fight against John Jones, or did he have a fight in between? Did he have a fight after that?
I think he had a fight after that.
Did he? Yeah, I think he may have. I can't remember now. But Daniel Cormier, in my opinion, hasn't looked like the best Daniel Cormier in some time. He even those fights against the fight against Anderson Silva. Remember the Anderson Silva fight at UFC 200 that he took at the last second, 48 hours notice or whatever it was?
Wait a minute. What weight class were they at?
They were in light heavy.
Exactly.
They were in light heavy. But I'm just saying, he took it. Well, I'm just going on the sample size that he's given us.
I'm just saying.
But he almost lost that fight against Anderson Silva. And had he not, you know, hugged him and sat on him for three rounds, he would have lost.
The thing is, man, trying to, you know, make that weight, especially a guy like Daniel Cormier, trying to make that light heavyweight, you know, that's a job, man. You know, this guy's used to walking around over 200 pounds. He's used to walking around a big guy, you know. So my thing is, like I said, it's going to be a whole lot easier for Daniel Cormier to come in fresh, come in, faster, you know, coming in with, you know, bringing his power with him, you know. And we've seen him go out there and knock out heavyweights, you know. I mean, I'm talking about just knock them out. And the thing is, the only fight that impresses me with Stipe is the Ngannou fight. You know what I mean? He outsmarted the guy. He literally rope-a-doped him. That's pretty much what happened right there. He rope-a-doped that big African. That African would have had, you know, somebody in his corner, you know, telling him the right things to do, because that's normally where you lose the fight at, in the corner.
Yeah.
You know? He ain't had no, you know, Angie Dundee over there telling him, you know, the right things to do. So that's the only fight that really impresses me is the Ngannou fight, because of what Ngannou had been doing leading up to that fight. That's the only thing.
Well, you can say that, but
it's true.
To go on the run that he's gone on.
Come on, man.
To go on the run that he's gone on is like almost unknown.
Can you not be like some of these guys, you know, who just don't want to agree no matter what? And we know who we're talking about. We ain't got to even say no names, though. You know what I mean? All right? You know, the Topolskis of the world. That's another story. Huh?
I'm just saying, I like Stipe Miocic. And I think that he is well on his way to be at least go down as one of the. And I think if he wins this fight, he is the greatest heavyweight in the history of the Ultimate Fighting Championship. But we're going to see it. And that fight that I was thinking of with DC was against Ozdemir. He had one fight after John Jones.
Yeah, he
was
beat up that boy Ozdemir.
He did.
Too.
He did. He actually looked decent.
No, he went out and crushed that boy Ozdemir.
Yeah, he beat him in the second round.
Yeah, he went out and smashed him. You know what I mean? So right now.
But Ozdemir not on the level of a Stipe Miocic or a John Jones.
Well, he thought he was.
He thought wrong on that one.
You got to be able to believe it. You got to be able to think in it before your mind can believe it. You know what I mean? That's what he said on the movie Life.
You know, that's a good one. You got to think it before your mind can believe it.
It's freaking crazy. No, but look here, man. I'm serious. DC. DC, I got DC third round by knockout.
Okay. I got to go in the distance.
Third round by knockout, because the thing is, I don't see DC really want to, you know, getting into a ground fight and making it long and just, you know, because the thing is, I don't think DC can tap out Stipe. I think that's what the difference is going to be. But I think he can take him down. I just don't think he can tap him out.
Take him down for sure.
I think he can take him down, but I don't think he's going to be able to tap him out. So that will be a long, grueling fight. So it's going to be all about them fifth ward beats. You know what I mean? Two-piece, side piece, and fries. That's what it's going to be about, guys. Hey, guys, stick around, guys. Heated conversation. We got a little bit more for you. Back in a minute.
Here's the thing.
Tonight, Joe. Back.
Can you feel it?
Feel it.
Welcome back to Heated Conversations on Sports Radio 610, y'all. You hear that? Destiny right there, y'all. Living in triumph. Oh, man. Go back and watch the video, man. Just go back and watch the video when they sprinkle the dust. You know, it's awesome. One of my favorite videos of all times, man. That's with all the brothers, you know, together. You know, you got Tito. You got Jermaine. You got Randy. You got Marlon. And you got that boy with the glitter socks on, Michael. There he is right there. Hey, man, I want to thank everybody for sticking around with me today and being a part of Heated Conversation. The best thing going today. I just wanted to give myself a pat on the back right there like Barry Horowitz from back in the day. You know,
that's a good poem.
Always give him a pat, give himself a pat on the back when no one else would. It doesn't matter. You know what I mean? Because I'm love myself like everyone should, man. But I tell you, man, awesome show today.
Yeah, it's been great. I want to shout out somebody here on the text line. They had a great idea about Brooklyn Nets buying out Dwight's contract and Dwight going to the Warriors. I like that idea. I
think Brooklyn will buy him out, but I hope he don't go to the Warriors.
I hope that he doesn't go to the Warriors because I'm a Houston Rockets fan, but I think that's a great place for him. I think that's a great fit for Dwight Howard.
I mean,
he's better than Looney or Zaza Pachulia, and he's an upgrade from Andrew Bogut.
He'll get a ring.
He'd definitely get that ring.
Hey, man.
Unless, LeBron comes to Houston, which he's coming to, by the way.
You know, man, you guys speak way too soon, man. You guys been talking about all kind of stuff, talking about LeBron James coming to Houston. Look, man.
Billboards are starting to pop up around the city.
Don't count your chickens before they hatch, all right? I mean, Mayweather has some billboards popping up around here at one point in time. He never came to town and did nothing, did he?
Yeah, I don't know what that was for. I don't remember why. I remember all the money team banners. I don't remember what that was for.
You saw him.
I saw him, though.
Did he come yet?
Maybe for All-Star Game.
Maybe with Oldman. You know
yeah, maybe
mean?
He was there because, for.
Yeah, yeah. So he's going
to
promote.
He went to some of those clubs, you know, over there on Richmond Avenue.
So he put billboards up.
Yeah, he just let people know he's coming.
A tweet is not good enough.
Tweet's not good. Not if you're Money Mayweather. You have to blow your money.
Oh, okay.
You have to spend it incessantly on nothing.
All right, man. Yeah. Whatever, man. Whatever. Yeah. Hey, man. Excuse me. The movie Creed.
Yes.
The new movie is coming out.
Creed 2.
Creed 2. And
we watched the trailer before the show started.
I've loved the Rocky franchise, man. I've loved all the Rocky movies, you know, and I tell you, you and I, we was having a debate earlier before we came on the air as far as Creed, where does it lie in the franchise?
Out of the seven films,
where does
Creed sit?
Where would you put Creed opposed to where I would put Creed? And the thing is, what would you put him? You know, let's tell the world.
Creed's up high there. It's very high for me. I think it's top three. It might be number three in the top three, but it's there.
I hope the listeners are out here listening to this because this is, it's a travesty that this young man don't know his history. I mean, he doesn't know his Rocky. He doesn't know, his Shakespeare's Roman. He doesn't know how much Sylvester Stallone put into, that movie.
Well, I know he wrote it himself. He refused to sell it to the studios unless he was attached to star in it.
I mean,
1979 won Best Picture.
It's parts of it, man.
Yeah.
I mean, did you know Sylvester Stallone? I mean, like you say, he wrote every line. You know, just like when his manager said, "Hey, boss, you might want to come take a look at this guy, man. You know, he looks real dangerous." You know, Apollo Creed said, "He's dangerous. I'm dangerous." You know, set it up. You know, that's how deep I go as far as my Rocky go, man. That's Rocky One. Rocky Two, Rocky Two, one of the greatest Rocky movies of all times. You know, I mean, you remember the scene, when his manager came in, when Apollo said, "Man, we're going to do the rematch." And his manager said, "Boss, I think, this guy's all wrong for us, baby. I saw, he said, why? He said, I saw you beat that man like you never beat a man before, and he just kept coming. We don't need no man like that in our lives. Let it go. Let it go. I don't know if you remember that, but I do. You know what I mean? One of the greatest movies of all, that's Rocky II, man.
Yeah.
Rocky III, Clubber Lang.
That's my favorite Rocky.
You know what? If that's your favorite, how can you dismiss one and two and just put three? Come on, man. You remember the scene when Rocky was getting ready to retire, and he was sitting there with Mick, and they gave him the big statue. And Apollo Creed came out and said, don't give him no statue. Give him guts.
To my Clubber.
Yeah, that's what I said, isn't it?
You said it to Apollo.
My man.
You were just thinking about how great of a movie Creed is.
Don't give him no statue. Give him guts, you know. You know, you and that chump know where I had to come from, you know. Yeah, you got your pretty little, you know what? You know, if you want to see a real man, you know, why don't you come over to my apartment tonight? And I'll show you a real man. That's what I'm talking about.
Clubber Lang,
that's
man.
That's Clubber, man.
Thunder Lips in the movie?
Rocky IV.
Yeah.
The Russian.
Drago.
You remember?
Brigitte Nielsen.
You remember that, man.
Yeah.
The world remembers
James
that.
James Brown was in it. Living in America. But look,
my point is this. My point is this. Let me calm down. My point is this. You know, Rocky I, great movie.
So is this your order? Are you going to give me your ranking?
I'm going to give you my ranking.
Okay, I'm going to write this down.
Rocky 1.
Mm-hmm.
Rocky 2.
Mm-hmm.
Rocky 3.
Okay.
Rocky 4.
All right.
Now, Rocky 5 with, you know, Winston, you know.
With Tommy Gunn.
Tommy Gunn, you know. It was a good movie. You know, maybe we could throw
Balboa first? Is Rocky Balboa, Rocky 6?
No, I mean, if we're going to throw one of these new movies, Creed, we could throw Creed in.
So Creed's at number 5.
At number 5. We can do that.
All right, then you put which one after that?
You know what? It doesn't really matter after that. You know, movies kind of like, you know, it's kind of like turn shades of gray, you know, after that. You know what I mean? So my thing is, first 5, you know, I mean, if we had to, you know, rank them in order or anything, I'd throw Creed in there as far as being pretty good, you know. But you know, I it's hard to say, though. It's hard to say.
For me, the best Rocky movie by far.
Wait a minute. If I had to put Creed in there, it would be at 5.
Okay.
But I'm going to tell you right now, Tommy Gunn was good. Tommy Morrison played a hell of a role.
Yeah,
the guy that played, I mean, come on, you can't in a boxing match all the
time.
Why? The drama was
That's
good.
What we want to see. We want to see a boxing match.
The other fights were in the ring when Tommy Gunn had to fight the bums.
I didn't want to see Rocky be the Mickey in that movie.
Look, man.
And then there's the whole thing with his son.
It was very confusing. Look, it was the drama, man. You get sometimes, you know, it don't always end in a fight. You know, when you go to movies, I just want you to know that.
Well, Rocky,
you know,
I went and watched
The Incredibles.
Yeah.
You know, and it didn't end in a fight. It was a lot of fighting going on, but it was a message there at the end, man. You need to understand that more than anything.
If Superman in a Superman movie doesn't put on his cape and have the S in the chest and go beat the bad guy, I'm going to be upset. Rocky Balboa had a leather jacket on in Rocky V and was street fighting with Tommy Hearn. This is not what I want to see.
Look, man, look here. It was Tommy Morrison anyway, not Tommy Hearn.
Tommy Morrison.
The thing is, man, the story had a lot of, you know, feel to it, you know, with him and his son. You know, his son was getting off into, you know, hanging out in the street. You know, some people these days could call that a gang, you know what I mean? He had started smoking cigarettes, you know. He had animosity towards his father, giving so much love to Tommy Gunn, you know. So it was a story there, man. It had a lot of emotion that Sylvester Stallone had to pour into that script. You wouldn't understand that because the only thing you're looking for is a boxing match. See, I can appreciate that right there.
Then why isn't Rocky V the best movie then?
Well, let me regroup. Rocky 1, Rocky 2, Rocky 3, Rocky 4, and Rocky 5. If we're going to put Creed in there somewhere, it got to be 6 or higher.
Oh, no. Here's my ranking. Rocky 3, best Rocky movie ever made. Then it's Rocky. Then it's Creed, Rocky 2, Rocky 4, Rocky Balboa, Rocky 5.
That's why you ain't writing no movies.
No, what that's do you why mean? Creed was a great
that's
movie.
That's why you're not, you know, involved in any of...
You know, I think that, you know...
We might even take you off the writing team, you know, reality wrestling, the creative team, after that ranking system you just gave. Because that man is ridiculous, man. It's ridiculous.
You don't think Creed was an excellent movie? Sylvester Stallone got nominated for an Oscar for it.
Did he win?
No, he won the Golden Globe.
Okay, there again.
The guy who directed.
I thought it was a good movie.
Black Panther.
I thought it was a good movie, but it wasn't a whole lot of action in it.
Oh man, the fight when he was there in Mexico at the very beginning—it kind of reminded you when Rocky was in the doldrums of the churches with Spider Rico.
Okay, that's one fight.
Okay, then there was the scene in the gym when he goes to L.A. and he's going against
the guy. That's not a fight.
They were sparring with each other. And he got knocked out.
I'm talking about a boxing match.
All right, there was two more after that, right? There was like his first fight when he came out as Donnie Johnson.
One fight,
and then when he became Adonis.
That two fights.
So, and then the one at the beginning. That's three. It's better than a street fight.
See what I'm saying? See what I'm saying? You
Ed, back me up on Creed. Creed was a great movie, right?
I haven't seen Creed.
Oh,
but
man.
I enjoyed this argument.
Let me tell you something. Let me tell you something, Eddie. It's the reason why you haven't seen it. If it was that great of a movie.
Well, have you seen the rest of the Rocky movies?
I seen one a long time ago, but I haven't seen the other one.
See?
How good was it?
It was pretty good.
Yeah, it is.
It won an Oscar for Best Picture.
He co-signed off on it, didn't he?
But I'm talking about when you think about Rocky III, Eye of the Tiger. Then he had Hulk Hogan in it. He had Mr. T in it.
All that started from the early days. What are you talking about? What are you talking about?
Eye of the Tiger.
It started
song.
From that. That's the beginning
the
of
song.
Rocky. What are you talking about?
That's the beginning of Rocky III. It didn't come into Rocky III. And Clubber Lang's the best villain he went against.
You telling me?
No, not that one. Rising up, back on the street.
Don't nobody care about that.
It's the
don't nobody in Rocky.
Eye of the tiger,
only thing people look here. Only thing people care about as far as the music in Rocky goes. I used to be in a band, man.
Can I tell you a story?
I used to be a drum major.
Can I tell you a story?
The trombone and the tuba section is the best part.
They just gave you the part with the least amount of notes so you wouldn't mess it up. Can I tell you a story? My parents got married in Vegas, and when they're getting ready to walk down the aisle, my mother's about to walk down the aisle. The organist was there to play the Here Comes the Bride, and she's walking, and she's like, why doesn't this sound right? And when they get up to the altar, my dad looks at her in the eye, and he goes, is he playing the Rocky theme? And they play the Rocky theme instead of Here Comes the Bride when they got married.
You know what? I always, pay my respects and, make sure I tip the bucket when it come around and whatnot.
That's probably a good idea.
Last time I went to church, man, I was so mad. I was so mad because my wife and I, we sit down, and the next thing I hear is... And I look up, and I go, that's my theme song. And I never went back to that church. I was so mad. I came to,
get in touch with the man.
Exactly, man. I mean, cleanse my soul. You know what I mean? I came to, pay my respects. I came to, let my kids hear the word.
That's right.
And I heard my music, man. My wife could co-sign on that, man. I was so freaking mad. Yeah.
Well, whatever you say, man. Booker, I still think Rocky 3 is the best Rocky, and then Creed,
you got
Rocky 2, Rocky
man,
4,
but,
Balboa, and 5.
The thing is, you mixed up because there would be no Rocky 3 if there was no Rocky 1. There would be
That's
no
true.
Rocky 3 if there was no Rocky 2. So you backwards there. And I understand that. I totally understand that. You know what I mean? So, hey, teach his own. That's the way people are. You part of this new millennium.
Oh, don't throw a label on me.
No, I mean...
Don't throw a label on
me. No, but you are. You are, man. You are.
You're just stuck in the past. You don't want to accept that something new.
No.
is the best.
Now, the thing is, man, good. you know, you're being negative. You know what I mean? You know, and that's just the way you are, bro. You know, some people
come off
like
a nice guy.
You do come off like a nice guy, but it's negative and you being negative. But hey, guys, that's the way this guy is. Hey, I want to thank you, though, man. I want to thank you.
I appreciate it.
I want to thank my man Ed, you know, for making this happen. This is the way it is, man. We're family here, man. This is a team thing, man. The teamwork is the dream work. Isn't that what they say?
That's what they say.
Teamwork is the dream work. I want to thank all the listeners out there for sticking around with me all day. This is what we do. Next week, guys, 7 to 9. We'll be doing it like it's supposed to be done, making them pay my son, making them bow down, making them say,
"Daddy, I don't want no."
I had enough. We about to roll up out this mug, y'all. I thank y'all. We out.